Hey everyone, this is Aaron Trevino down here in the beautiful state of Texas. And today we have a repeat guest, and there is a reason for that. We have Justin Harrison with Futures Financial. How are you doing today, Justin?
I'm well, man. How's it going with you?
I'm good. I'm good. We're talking at an interesting time. I know we reconnected and, you know, there's a lot going on in the market. You've been working on some neat projects, and I thought it'd be nice to have you on the show and talk a bit about what you've been doing and some new construction loans.
Appreciate it, man. Yeah, no, it's been good on this end. Just sorting through, a lot of different scenarios, which is good, right? I'd rather be busy than bored, which is obviously a good sign. Company's still growing, and there's been a lot of questions in the market. Depending on which market you're in, some are still growing. You've been seeing a little bit more stagflation in some markets. So, I'm happy to be on here to help discuss and help out your viewers.
Absolutely. And, you know, it's interesting. It seems like you have a wide variety of products and just different things you've worked on yourself. When you think of a loan or a construction loan, you don't exactly think of, hey, this is going to get me to build wealth. You know, what's that connection there? How can construction loans actually in the long term help you build wealth?
Yeah, definitely. It's definitely a walk before you run business for sure. On the construction side. But your margins, if you do it right, are also a little bit larger than some more traditional fix and flips, for example. Just think about it, you buy the land, right? And then every step of the way, you're actually adding value to the property. So whereas, in a fix and flip, you have the value, you take it away, and then you add to it, times two, right? But construction is very interesting because every single nail you put into the asset, you're actually building and adding value there. Helps build your wealth overall.
Absolutely. And it kind of seems like compared to flips, obviously there is risk if you are breaking ground and doing construction, but in a sense, it's not like you can get into the house and you find out there's all these problems, right? Because you're building from the ground up.
Yeah, man, you're the one creating the problems if you don't
right.
do it right. So
yeah,
definitely. It's advanced Lego set, you know?
Yeah, completely. Could you explain a bit, we know that you're, heavily on the finance side, you deal with a lot of different, types of transactions. How exactly does a construction loan work, right? So if I'm maybe a first time builder, developer, and I want to learn more about construction loans, how exactly does it work?
Yeah, for sure. So it's actually a two part question. So for one, you needed, obviously, financing plays a massive role in the construction field, right? So I highly encourage people, and it's kind of an industry standard now to an extent, is that if you're truly a first-time builder, it also helps with the learning curve, is partner up with somebody who has built a house before. I mean, that could be a GC, it could be a true developer, whomever you know, but that's going to help you a lot. A, it's going to help you secure financing a lot easier than two. I mean, it's going to shorten the learning curve by so much. I mean, because you don't know what you don't know, so that also helps in that component as well.
Absolutely, and I know one thing that people get hung up on with lenders or kind of poke at lenders about is the experience, right? It's, hey, does this count as experience? Or technically, I'm not, but I kind of know someone who is. What exactly counts as experience when you're doing a first-time construction deal?
Yeah. So experience is as simple as we do a title search, right? So if you've said you've built 123 Main Street, my processing team will simply pull title on that property. So whether it be in your name or give me the name of the LLC that you constructed the property in, just give us that information. And then we're going to basically just do a title search and pull that up. So that's how we're able to verify it. So I hear it a lot from GCs. I understand you've built X amount of houses or you've participated in X amount of houses. We just, from a lending perspective, want to make sure that you've had the capacity to do this from soup to nuts at the end of the day. That's it.
Sure. And is that the same thing as a sold HUD? Like if I were to work on a project, you would want to see that my name was on it and you could verify, hey, he was part of this, right?
Yeah. And you don't have to be necessarily you didn't have to necessarily be the personal guarantor in the loan itself. But if you had, ownership in the LLC that was a part of that deal, shoot me over the operating agreement, we'll be able to easily put A and B together. So that way you can get your credit as well.
Absolutely. And, how exactly do you get approved, right? Because it seems like there's so many aspects of the lending field. It's right. Maybe I want to buy a home for the first time, or maybe I want to develop something for the first time, W-2 and credit, or I don't need it. What for, you know, for a construction loan, for a hard money construction loan, how do you get approved?
Yeah. So, you know, there's a couple different ways to do it. I can only speak on how we look at it from Futures Financial's perspective. And so how we look at it is that we're a shovel ready lender, right? So we won't necessarily lend on the land itself. So granted, there are some lenders that'll do the land and do the horizontal work for you. But essentially what we do is once the plans and permits have been stamped and approved, we'll do the vertical, meaning that we'll do the, you know, construction budget, right? We'll finance that aspect of it and then collateralize the land. So then you can pull some equity out of there to roll towards your project. But we don't, credit does play a factor for sure. I mean, and preferably we want north of 660, you know, if it's a little bit lower than that, all good as long as it's north of six. But I just want to see if it's due to over or underutilization, or it's a different story if you have a lot of, you know, late payments. But and then as far as income qualification goes, we actually don't verify income or employment. We simply look at 2 months of bank statements to make sure there's enough liquidity to cover if you have to come out of pocket for anything. And then we just want to see reserves. So that's all we're really looking at as far as qualifying from a liquidity standpoint.
Absolutely. And could you go back to when you talked about collateralizing the land? Because that's another big question that folks could have as well is, should I buy the land in cash myself and then just simply get a construction loan just for the straight up construction? Or should I have the lender finance land plus construction?
So at least in my field, it's a little more rare to find a lender who's going to do both. And if you do both, it's usually a lower leverage on land. I mean, realistically, 30% lower against the land, right? Because it's a raw piece of land. There's no true value. There's potential. But at that point in time, there's no true value on the land itself. So whether or not you should buy, I personally recommend buying it cash if you can, solely because, you know, from a financing perspective, we look at it from a loan to cost, right? So you're taking in that total cost from the land plus the construction. So then if you've bought the land in cash, depending on what the ratio is from the lot value to the actual weight of the construction budget, you know, which we can go into detail later if you want, you can actually pull out some of that equity that you've already put in the property from the land value itself. And sometimes the land value will slowly increase once the permits have been issued, because now it's looked at, okay, this is actually a piece of earth that I can actually go and do something with today. So I personally would recommend buying it cash, but it really just depends on the size of the lot that you're buying.
Sure. Yeah, I guess it's also not only the financing part, but also the logistics part, right? It's kind of, you know, hey, do I really want two closings, or could I just have one, or what's easier, or really what's going to help? What does the lender want ultimately, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's very tough. I mean, look, in the conventional world, you know, the Fannie Freddie world, I understand there are these one-time close products. Full transparency, I'm not extremely familiar with those because I don't work in those on a day-in, day-out basis. Typically when a deal comes to us, it is already shovel ready to an extent, or they're buying the land, they want to get their financing in order on the, you know, because it takes time. I mean, depending on your market, to get those plans and permits, you know, approved. Some states like Texas, for example, are going to be a lot quicker than states like California, for example, you know, just for a variety of reasons. But you kind of have to know what the turn times are in your area as well to help you plan accordingly.
Absolutely. And, you know, what really is, you know, if a builder or developer is, you know, is doing a deal with y'all, right? What's the incentive to using hard money as opposed to going through a local bank or maybe self-funding or something like that?
Yeah. With us, it's really speed. And I started off in the true institutional side of private money, still doing construction, but true institutional, right? And with us, we're more a boutique company now in a sense. So we actually really help you out on the back end. So it's one thing to get the best terms, the best interest rate, so on and so forth on the front end, but it's a whole nother process in the back end. You need draws issued, or, you know, you need to pull from a contingency, or you need to swap out a line item. So that's where we really come into play and help the clients in the back end. So it is very important to just make sure that you have a lender that is well-rounded and actually specializes in the construction sector because it's going to help, because the turn times and the draws could make or break your project because you have to make sure your contractors are paid and so on and so forth.
Exactly as well. And I think that also, you know, like you mentioned, kind of comes down to servicing and having someone that's familiar, you know, hey, more or less, this is how long this type of project will take. You know, he's going to need this many draws. And it's good to have someone like yourself who's well versed in not only the language, but also like, hey, what's this project going to look like the next few months?
Definitely. And not even just about futures, but just in general for any company that anybody's looking for, specifically in the construction sector, like, don't be afraid to ask the additional questions of like, hey, like, have you done this yourself? Does the person that runs your, whoever you're dealing with on the draw side, are you dealing with one person? Are you dealing with just a number in the system? You know, do they have development experience? Because you know how it goes, like developers, borrowers, lenders, and appraisers, they all speak different languages and all try to come together to make one project work, you know? So it's always important to know who you're really working with.
So true. And how are interest rates affecting the construction industry, right? We've kind of seen this shake up. So much has changed over the past few years. Why is it important to look at what interest rates are doing and how would it affect doing construction?
So I haven't seen the interest rates play a massive role in the construction side. I've actually seen it plays a role in the sense that your carrying costs have obviously increased, right? And then you're on the back end, should you decide to sell the property, your buyer's pool has slightly decreased, right? Just because less as a whole at 7-8% interest rates, less people qualify than when they're at, you know, 3-4%, right? That's just the nature of the game. But I haven't seen a massive I when their interest rates were really increasing rapidly, I definitely saw some people halting just to figure out where everything was going to go. But now that we're in a more stabilized environment, I mean, sure, are they higher than a couple of years ago? Sure. But you know, if you look at the 30-year graph, a 30-year chart, we're pretty even overall. So I think a lot of people who are experienced or at least have seen a market cycle or two aren't really barking at the interest rates as much as somebody who's just newer to the game, who's only been, you know, involved for, I would say, like maybe 3 year cycle, give or take.
Yeah, great insight there. And why should it kind of seems like it's a bit of a paradox, right? Why does taking on debt actually build wealth in the long run?
Taking on debt is, I mean, it's just how you leverage, right? You have to be able to leverage smartly. Now, I'm not a financial advisor, right? And I think everybody kind of knows good debt versus bad debt, right? And historically, real estate has always been looked at as good debt, right? Because even at scale, you pretty much you're hedging your bets, right? So if you can buy, you know, I think people have heard the example, if you have $100,000, right? You could buy $100,000 house outright cash, or you can buy, you know, let's just say four houses with 25% down per house, right? Even if the market goes up or goes down, or you might have a tenant issue in one of the houses, you still can make it up on the other side. So at scale, a lot of people do use debt to build wealth solely because you're going to net X amount of cash flow, assuming your numbers are right, and it helps you just build wealth over time. And then as rates adjust, you know, if you buy them at, let's say you get in the deal at 7% today, 4 years from now, let's say it's at 5%, you have the built-in appreciation. You pay down some of the you pay down the note, you choose to refinance, your payment decreases, and historically rents have always increased or property values have always increased. So you just slowly build that note from there.
Absolutely. And I guess on that note, with that being said, are there any particular types of products that you see people really going for right now? Is it mostly a rental product or a construction product, or what are people sort of gravitating towards?
Honestly, it depends on the state. So we do this on a pretty close to national level. So, you know, about 38 different states, right? So I've been in the space for about 8 years now. And so I've been pretty much worked in the same basic 30 to 38 states. So it depends on your market. Like when I'm in the, like if I'm in the Midwest, like in Ohio or in Indiana, for example, I see a lot more like rental loans, like DSCR loans that come through those versus a California who's mostly a, it's an appreciation market, you know, so you see more value out on that end. So it's hard to give you a straightforward answer on it because it's kind of subjective to whichever market you're specifically referring to.
Okay. What about Texas?
Texas is interesting. So Texas is one of these interesting states where you can actually get both as long as you buy it correctly. Now, Texas obviously has slightly higher property tax than some other states do, but it's one of these states that you can actually get both. And I think prior to, let's just say, the COVID boom or the COVID great migration, whatever you want to label it as, I think it was personally a little bit more of a cash flow market than appreciation market at scale. And now, especially like take the big three, which is Dallas, Austin, Houston, right? They've seen such an influx of people that the values have significantly gone up. So now you just have to pick your spots a little bit more. So the same single families in Dallas specifically, because I'm a little bit more familiar with the Dallas market, might not be cash flowing as heavy as they were a couple of years ago, but you can still kind of get a blend of both right now. So I think Texas is a good market if you want to kind of dip your toe in the to both, I guess, both realms of real estate.
I guess so, and that's it kind of ties into that that housing shortage as well, right? Which also ties into
100%.
the new construction loans. So it all kind of feeding itself, right?
100%. I mean, and now, I mean, not to get too granular, but we saw a spike in lumber, right? So that you have to look at it, the prices are going up on these houses and the interest rates, but it's also the, I mean, labor costs as well as material costs are also going up, which is you pair that with the shortage, and here we are.
Yeah, completely. And I guess speaking of, I guess maybe exiting a deal as well, right? So let's say everything's lined up, whether you're a first time builder, you're doing it, a few repeat times, you get through the deal. How do you plan your exit, right? Do you find that a lot of people did they build to rent and they refinance out, or are they building to sell mostly? Or how do you plan an exit strategy when you're doing a construction deal?
First of all, I think it's important to have a true strategy from the get. So if you don't go into a ground up construction deal thinking, I might sell it, I might refi, I don't know yet, right? Always have a plan to flip it. I mean, well, to not flip it, but to call an audible, let's just say. But if I see a lot more people looking to build to sell personally. Now, the ones that come out the gate like, hey, I want to build this and I want to hold on to this for a long term, I typically see that more with like, we technically go up to 50 units, right? But I see that more, on the, if we're talking about true consumer space, is like 1 to 4 unit properties. So I would definitely make sure that people are aware and understand how like a DSCR loan works, which is debt service coverage ratio, which in English is just the property has to cash flow, right? So if your ARV, which is after repair value, is, let's just say, $500,000, just using the simple numbers, right? That's the value. And if your loan amount, let's just say, is 350, you want to make sure that whatever their market rents are in the area, you can get like a 1007 on the appraisal, right? Will be able to show that, okay, if I do nothing else but pay off the 350 that I have or refi and keep the same 350 note, at that loan amount, I can still cash flow at X dollar amount based on the market rents. So it's just something that you want to kind of take a couple steps ahead and just make sure that if I don't pay down this note, if it doesn't go up at this dollar amount that I'm borrowing, I can still cash flow the property. So I think it's very important for people to understand how to calculate it on the back end to make sure actually get, and give you peace of mind while you're building the property as well.
Absolutely. So that DSCR would it would just be a loan saying, hey, is this gonna cash flow? Yes or no, right?
Yes. So regular 30-year, a 30-year product, right? Looked at the very similarly to any other product, banks, 2 months of bank statements, right? It's just making sure that the property cash flows. I mean, some people run a break-even model, all good, but we want to make sure that you're actually, getting a little bit of a profit on it because there's always gonna, it's real estate, there's always gonna be a rainy day, something's always gonna break. So we want to make sure that, and we want you to know that you can actually make money off this asset.
Absolutely. And I guess speaking of making money as well, we talked a bit about exits as well. One question people have is building generational wealth. I know you talked a bit about, being able to take on debt and, being able to build wealth over time as well. How is the construction space really offering a unique opportunity to build wealth? Do you have to do high volume, a lot of really small deals over and over again, or should I just do the best that I can to build as big of a property as I can? What do you think?
I think it's the main caveat with that, specifically in the ground up construction space, is you have to really be able to pick your spots. So you have to make sure that if you're building, you have to know where you're building, right? Like if you just, I actually see it a couple of times. You see people pick these random plots of land and they just hope that it works, right? Now, depending on what state you're in, there's been a lot of changes from the legislative side that, especially in California, just once again to the housing shortage, that like there's SB9 programs, SB35 programs, depending on where you're at. But you can, if you buy a big enough lot, or take Texas, for example, if you bought a house sitting on an acre and the neighborhood can, can hold it, you can subdivide the lot, right? So now you're building additional houses and you're creating more generational wealth because now your returns are X amount more. And all you did was get permits to slice the lot in half and build potentially four identical properties, two identical properties, a single family, an ADU, whatever it is. You just get the more bang for your buck that way. And once again, if you do it right, the returns on ground up construction are usually a lot greater than a traditional fix and flip. But once again, real estate, it's all in how where you buy.
Yeah, I guess at least from a Texas lens, it kind of sounds like that's where the local knowledge comes into play, right? Because
For
maybe
sure.
developing in Dallas, San Antonio has different rules from Houston, who has no zoning, right? So.
Houston's a it's a wild place. compared to California, where you have to get, I mean, if you miss a, if you have a spelling error, it gets sent back, right? In Houston, when I love it when I get construction deals in Houston. I'm like, okay, I already know this is probably going to be approved and we'll be
Sure.
okay to go.
Yeah,
100%.
they want to get it done, right? Everyone's motivated.
100%. And
Yeah.
then also, just one last thing, I don't want, I well, on this specific topic, that I do see people run in, this could be a pitfall for some people who are also looking to build that generational wealth, especially in different markets. Make sure you understand what time of year you're building, because if you're in an area like, say, like Chicago, for example, there's 3 months at least out of the year that you're not really going to be able to do that much of a build, so make sure that you're doing all your buying and you can time out the permits. Make sure you try to get that so that whenever you are ready to break ground, you can knock it all out in X amount of months. Just that's 2 cents.
I generally don't have to think about that too much, being down here in Texas where it's warm.
Yeah, I mean, still, it's like, yeah, Lord, but you have your couple months out the year where it's cold, but it's not, I mean, just depends. Yeah, you have a lot more freedom in Texas for sure, as far as your ability to build year round. Definitely.
Sure, absolutely. And I guess, speaking of, I don't know, when you think of cold, you think of freezes, which could damage the property. And at least here in Texas, it kind of reminds me of, we have storms, we have hurricanes as well, maybe a bit of flooding. So, do you see that ever being an issue with funding construction deals or not really?
Oh yeah. I see it a lot actually when we do it. We do bills in Florida specifically, because of the same situation, and a lot of it stems from insurance. So it's not as much as whether or not you build here. Under obviously, if you're building in a floodplain, that's one situation right there, right? Or you see it in Louisiana, for example, right? Like you're literally building in somewhere that is prone to flooding. That's one thing. But the biggest handicap right now for a lot of builders, depending on what market you're in, is honestly the insurance companies. Because they're not binding certain pro or it's tougher for them to bind in certain areas, right? So that's slowing down their entire project, or it's significantly increasing their cost. So either A, that has to be a pass through to the consumer, hence increased property prices, or they eat it and try to get it done, in a quicker timeline to hedge for their carrying costs. So, but I would say insurance is a big factor to the construction loans that typically isn't talked about as much.
Absolutely. Have you ever seen, out of curiosity, have you ever seen a deal where maybe part of the property is in a floodplain, or is it, how does that work? Is it all in or all out or?
I haven't seen anything that's like 1 foot in, 1 foot out
Yeah.
personally.
Yeah.
But I haven't seen it. What I have seen, this was like last year, and it was a trip because it was a mid construction deal, right? some developer or builder, whomever was trying to do the pro was trying to build the house. It didn't work out for them, so they had to walk away. I don't know the backstory on that side of things. I just know I think they ran out of money, lender, whatever. But the new borrower, like I guess the county had reassessed that area. Something, once again, don't hold me to this story, but it made it significantly harder for that individual to even get funding. It well, mostly from it was one of my deals that I was working on, because that goes back to the insurance, because it took insurance literally close to 3 weeks to bind. And granted, it was a larger property, don't get me wrong, but still, like usually you get quotes back in 2 3 days, and this was literally taking 3 weeks because the insurance companies didn't want to touch it. So that is something that people need to factor in.
Completely. Wow. And that's not exactly the news that you want to hear, right? Like when you get into a deal mid-construction, they say, "Hey, Mr. Jones, your deal's going to be a lot harder to do now."
Yeah, I mean, it is, the
Yeah.
budget hasn't changed, the borrower's experience, like nothing's changed. It's just you have to have insurance to build, or at least to get financing, So
Right.
that is a big factor right now, actually, in the construction space.
Huh. I guess, it would I'm curious now as well about mid-construction deals, right? Because if you're doing new construction, you obviously, the intention is for you to see the project out and, you sell and make your money and do the next one, right? But there is obviously an element of risk. And what are kind of the pros and cons of, maybe you taking over a mid-construction deal? And from your perspective as a lender, is that harder to get approved for, or what is that like from a lending perspective?
Yeah, so I actually do actually my as far as the construction side goes, I actually see pretty equal amount of true ground up and then true mid construction. Right now, the interesting part about mid construction is extremely subjective. Typically, if it's framed up, there's a roof. If it's basically pretty much like a shell at that point, then that's a little bit easier. But if it's still in the drywall phase, or you still have exposed beams, depending. A big X factor is what it appraises at. So some people will look at it like land value plus cost to date. Some people will just, it depends on when you bought it. There's a couple different X factors that go into it. But overall calculations are pretty much looked at the same way as a true ground up construction, right? Because essentially if it's a mid construction, the C of O hasn't been issued yet. So you're just pretty much splitting it down between like, okay, what did the land cost? How much, or how long ago did they buy it as well, right? And then your budget is split between like, okay, what's been spent to date, and then what still needs to be spent. Now, getting those figures are a lot easier if it's their project. Some individuals just try to do it cash, and they run out of cash. They look at the refinance, similar to like a ground up deal, and then you just continue on the project versus somebody actually buying a construction deal, So it's looked at the same way, but it's just that extra step or two. And once again, it kind of goes back. It's a little tougher to buy from an insurance side.
Sure, that makes a lot of sense. And I guess that's the downside of self-funding, right? Because I mean, maybe you could pull a couple $100,000 out of your own bank account, but I mean, you're not going to see that money until you may get the proceeds from the sale, right?
Exactly. And the biggest thing is just always be honest about, or I don't say honest, but realistic with yourself of what you think the value is. The ARV is the ARV, right? It's going to fluctuate depending on, time of year, depending on if interest rates have increased, decreased, right? Like, so you can ballpark it within maybe a 10% delta, right? But a lot of it's going to come into what stage is the property in now, and what's the estimated as is value, because to your point, if you're going to want to recoup some of that money you've spent, that's where a lot of the money is going to be coming back to you from, depending on how far along the project you are.
Absolutely. Well said. What do you make? I know none of us have a crystal ball, but what do you make of these next, call it 6 to 12 months? Do you see construction picking up, or are there any trends that you're seeing as we approach maybe halfway through the year?
Yeah, I've per it's a there's a couple factors here. A is that, we're in a quantitative tightening cycle at a macro level, right? So money's not flowing as freely. So a lot of the banks, which I know we went through the regional banking crisis like a couple months ago ish, I've lost track of time. So you're starting to see a lot of the finance, a lot of the institutions tighten, right? And so that's one factor because it's a little bit tougher to get approved. So now you're seeing a lot more. I think I saw stuff, I think it was Axios. I forget who published it, but that they like one in three houses right now are being bought in cash. Now, granted, I don't know if that stat is they're using like private money, hard money as a cash purchase versus writing a check per se, or saying a wire, I should say, you know. But in this market, I can only speak from the investment side of things. I there's a lot more on the value add side that I've seen because people are seeing more bang for their buck on the value side versus just buying regular rental properties because for cash flow reasons. Because with the interest rates going up, you have to put more down to offset, you know, the rising interest rates. And that's one part of it. The other part is, look, it's real estate. It's always going to go up. It's always gone up in the past. There's some markets that it hasn't, obviously, but I see it can, I see it loosening up a little bit right now because a lot of loans that were at a 3 to 5%, if they were on like a 3-year or 5-year ARM, are starting to mature. So we start to see that. So we're starting to see more and more properties either hitting the market or a lot more refinance inquiries, right? So that I'm seeing a lot of that. Trying to think, there's one other thing that's been standing out to me is that I've seen a lot more development, to be honest, a lot more builders coming in because for the same reason we just spoke about, right? It's actually more profitable right now to, depending on what market you're in, to just build something from the ground up than it is to try to take it, buy it, fix it up, and then resell it, you know? So I think I and with the housing shortages right now, I see a lot of people continue to build, continue to expand, continue to build multifamily properties or just build ADUs or casitas, depending on what market you're in. And it's as an addition to the existing SFR. So a couple different factors. I know it's very broad. It just depends on which market you're in, you know?
Sure. Would you call those infill lots, right? So maybe those casitas or ADUs, would you call that? I guess for those who don't know, could you explain what an infill lot is and why lenders prefer to fund those sorts of construction deals?
Yeah, I mean, because you actually have something like you have a better sense of collateral, right? So if you already have a structure on the lot, assuming, you know, because you have one lot, like picture like a square, and then that's an APN, right? That's your parcel number. So if there's already a house sitting there, and I'm speaking for like the vast majority, right? We'll use that existing property there as collateral to lend, and you know, whether they're building an ADU or they're whether it be a junior ADU or a detached ADU. Or whatever it may be that they're building, right? Depending on the lot, maybe they split it up and they go ahead and build another whole house on there, depending on which space you have. Now, the one thing to look out for though is that most lenders are going to want to be in first position on that house. So if you bought that rental property, then you want to build an ADU, all good. But you might be saying goodbye to that, you know, that 3-4%. So it's just something that you have to calculate. It's a calculated risk, you know. But I mean, we like it more because it's God forbid something happens, like you have a leverage against an existing asset versus a plot of land, you know?
Sure, that makes a lot of sense as well. I just thought I'd ask about the infill part, and when you mentioned, hey, it's actually a better time to develop right now because it just makes more sense on paper, right?
Yeah, but make sure that you know what you're doing, you know, because like it same reason that we said, like the mid construction deals. You have to know what you're doing. So definitely get with a partner. You're not going to make as much profit on the first one, maybe even the second one, right? And I can speak from personal experience. I've been doing loans for ground up deals for a while now. It doesn't mean I can go out there and build a house. I don't have those skill sets. So like I would actually be able to partner up with somebody, which is the same way you have to look at it from when an institution or a bank or a lender, whoever it is giving out that money. They want to make sure they have to have confidence in you. So if you say, hey, me and my buddy who's built X amount of houses, we're going to partner up, you're going to get better pricing solely because you're a buddy, and it's going to help you out because, you know, hey, congratulations, man, you just built a house. Like it's not an everyday thing that people do.
So true, especially when you mentioned mid-construction as well, because you don't know if there's any existing issues or why they ran out of money, the backstory, and then it kind of sounds like you need somebody in your corner who knows how long the work is going to take, and ultimately knows, hey, how much is this material going to cost too, right?
Yep, and always have a contingency on your budget. I mean, we require 15%. Some lenders are less. I don't know anybody too much higher than that, to be honest with you. And just be realistic. I mean, it's construction, right? Like, if you think it's going to take you 5 months to build it, probably be more like seven. It's just the nature of the space for one reason or another.
Okay. And could you explain contingency? So they're needing to add 15% of the budget just as padding, or what is that?
Yeah, definitely for padding. So let's just say your budget, let's use easy numbers and say your budget's $100,000. Then like, if that's your hard cost, framing, paint, flooring, appliances, vanity, so on and so forth, all that totals up on a per line item to, let's just say, $100,000. So then there's a little, at least we have on our budgets, there's a little additional space for a contingency. So then you would just times whatever that budget is by 15%. And then that actually gives you your total budget. So usually you want to bake in a little bit of a delta in the line item. I wouldn't go down to the actual, cent, right? Because you can go to Home Depot, buy whatever else. You could price it out. 3 months later, they went up a little bit, right? Just if that's your supplier, for example, for certain items. So always add in that contingency, because things will go up, things will go down. And you might price it out as, oh, this was going to cost X, but actually this isn't going to cost as much, but I'm going to need to pull extra from this area because now that I want to do this flooring and now I want to do this flooring instead. Or, it's human nature, right, to kind of change our minds as the project goes. So it just gives you that a little bit extra peace of mind, and to know that you had that little extra padding just in case.
Okay, that makes a whole lot of sense, especially, how you mentioned where, you want to make sure that everything's teed up and you have the highest likelihood of getting through the deal and doing the next one too, right?
Definitely. It's just, if you always have a little bit of extra money set aside just in case. And I mean, we just my mom just actually redid her bathroom, and even though it was a smaller remodel job in the bathroom, I mean, that we like we know a GC that went and did it, but even him, he had to have an extra day or extra 2 days because they turned out to be like a plumbing issue, right? Like a pipe was like would turn out to actually be leaking. So just again, that extra little bit of an expense just to get that fixed up, and that's just a bathroom rental. We're not talking about a whole house, so there's always something
Yeah,
expected.
always
There's
something.
always something.
That's funny. I guess out of curiosity as well, maybe this sounds like a dumb question, but when exactly do you call the lender, right? Because you think, okay, well, I think I may have this land, or I already do have this land. I bought it in cash and I just need the construction. Where is the lend where is my phone call to the lender coming in all of this?
Are you talking about pre-funding or post-funding?
Pre-funding.
So pre-funding, I mean, it depends on your experience, like if you're just starting out, I would say the earlier the better, right? So I'll get calls from people who are, they've built X amount, or I would say reach out as early as you can. Whether somebody you've been working with for X amount of time, or it's a brand new relationship, and you're trying out a different person, reach out the sooner the better, because you don't know what you don't know. And if you base everything off of one specific strategy, how you think it'll go, but then in reality that it doesn't go like that, it could have been avoided based on one phone call, So I would get that, and I would get the information of how the draws work on the back end, So what's the turn times on those? What paperwork do I have to submit for those? Am I doing it as an owner builder? Am I hiring a GC to do it? So certain different things just to ask the lenders on the different policies on the back end. The front end is the front end, right? It's pretty standard as on that side of things. But on the back end, like, how do the draws work? What's the timeline from when I submit this? How long before I get my money back? What I need to show? So ask all those questions up front, and then that way you can plan accordingly, and then you can pick your team accordingly as well.
Beautiful. Makes a whole lot of sense. Well, Jesse, is there anything you haven't said you'd really just like to hit home for us?
My biggest thing is just, I mean, look, don't be scared of it, right? It just take a calculated risk. Never put all of your money into one project or even two projects, right? Always make sure you have reserves. And we require you to have a 6 month buffer, just be able to show. So always make sure you have a buffer, because let's be realistic, you have other life things, right, outside this one project that you're working on. So just make sure don't overextend yourself. Take the extra time to get with the right team, and then take the extra time to go with the right lender that makes the most sense for your strategy and your skill level. So I would say just take the extra couple minutes to do your due diligence.
Absolutely. Makes a lot of sense. You know, everybody, we will have Justin's information in the show notes, right? So if you want to book a call with him, you want to connect, maybe you have a deal, you just want some more info for later on when you do, Justin's your guy. So is there anything you'd like to, any parting words, anything you'd like to say before we sign off?
Well, look, you guys are in great hands. I mean, I always love being, it's my second time on here. I always love talking to Aaron. He's good people. So anything I can do to help, please, you know, get my information from Aaron or however you want to distribute it out. Once again, my name is Justin Harrison, company's Futures Financial. But you guys are in great hands, whoever your viewers are, from all skill levels. So I've known Aaron for a couple of years now. So I so appreciate the time, appreciate you taking the time, and always look forward to talking to you, man.
Hey, I appreciate the kind words, Justin. Well, you know, as mentioned, we will have Justin's info in the show notes. So if you do want to connect with him, it'll be there. Justin, we talked about a lot. We talked a little bit about DSCR, new construction, being a first-time builder developer, and really just going through the entire process, exit strategies. It's been great. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming on the show. It's always a pleasure.
Of course, man. Always a pleasure. I appreciate you so much. Thank you for taking the time, and I'm more than happy to help.
Yes, sir. All right, y'all. Sign off from Houston, Texas, and we will talk to y'all later.